सदाशिवसमारम्भां शङ्कराचार्यमध्यमां अस्मदाचार्यपर्यन्तां वन्दे गुरुपरम्पराम् ओम् वी आर् इन् द बिगिनिङ्ग् आफ् दि 15th चाप्टर् आफ् द भगवद्गीता वी आर् वेरी इण्टरेस्टिङ्ग् वर्सस् टु बी टु डिस्कस् वेर् वी नीड् टु नो आल् द नालेज् दट् वी हेड् इन् तत्त्वबोध वी बिगिन् वित् वर्स् 3
Yes, sir. Verse 3 goes like this. Na rupam asya iha tato
balapukasya.
Nanto na cha adi na sampratishta. Ashvattham enam suvirudha moolam. Asanga shastrena dridhena chitva. Here, samsara dosha darshanam leads to moksha ichha, and this is a prerequisite for brahma gnanam. In last class we have seen description of samsara vruksha. We have seen samsara being compared to eternal peepal tree with tap roots, shoots, leaves. We have seen branches being nourished by gunas and shoots being compared to sense objects. So in continuation of that, Krishna in this particular verse explains and continues with samsara varnanam. The verse has two parts. The initially continuation of samsara varnanam as first two verse and half of this verse, and the later half of this verse will give us samsara nivrutti upaya. So in continuation with samsara varnanam, Krishna says, the more we probe on samsara, the more mysterious it becomes. And this is an eternal mystery. Coming to the verse line by line, asya rupam na upalabhyate. That is, the nature of this universe is incomprehensible. We can never separate time, space, or creation. We can never look for the time when it started or when it ends, and similarly time, space and creation, when we have to talk about it, we'll have to go for a theory of causation. And the second line says na adi na sampratishta and na anta. This universe, when we keep probing it, the mysterious it gets. It has no beginning, it has no middle, it has no end. We cannot talk about this as beginning and end of creation and time are intellectually not comprehensible, unimaginable. And instead of struggling to understand this samsara or solve the mystery, we have to get rid of this. We have to look for samsara nivrutti. So with these lines, samsara varnanam has been done in first half of the verse. Now, Krishna gives samsara nivrutti upaya. How to get out of this vicious, terrible, uncontrollable, unpredictable samsara chakra? Lord Krishna talks about four methods or four disciplines, and these are not optional. All four are important. That is, the first is vairagyam, that is dispassion. Next, he talks about Brahma Vichara, that is inquiry into the root of samsara vriksha. And next is Sharanagati, that is surrender or devotion. And next is, the fourth one is Sadguna, or developing healthy, refined mind. Here, the first one is mentioned here. When we see the verse, Asanga Shastrena, that is, Asanga means vairagya, dispassion or detachment, and shastram means weapon. It could be an axe or a sword. Asanga shastrena, that is, with the axe of vairagyam, you may learn to reduce your dependence on the world and may gradually develop God dependence. So moving from world dependence to God dependence through vairagyam, that is, by using acts of vairagya, you can cut down your world dependence. Dridena chitva, it has to be strongly and forcibly it has to be done. Evam suvirudha moolam ashwattham, that is the people tree, suvirudha moolam, that is you may cut the dependence on this well rooted and strongly rooted ashwattha vriksha or this samsara vriksha. Swamiji says you love people, move with people, show your care, everything you do, but you need stability and security, and for this Lord has to be source for the security. So move from world dependence to God dependence, and this is maturity. So this verse talks about detachment, and the other three disciplines will come in next verse. We will see the other three discipline description. Hari Om.
Thank you, Satya, for a very nice description of verse number 3. The first half continues, as you said, about the description of samsara. And the second half deals with a very firm treatment of samsara. That means you should be ready to chop the tree of samsara by the acts of detachment, which is defined here as vairagya. First, we should understand that samsara is a problem. Only those who are able to understand samsara as a problem can take up the acts of vairagya to detach it. When do you realize that samsara, or when do you realize that it is possible to cut the tree of samsara? I just want you to mentally think, who can possibly do that? See, samsara is so beautiful. This world is so nice. We have invested so much in this world. And do you think it is possible for us to chop off this all that we have created? We have so meticulously nurtured and created our own samsara. It is extremely difficult for us to take that axe and chop it off. Who can do it? I want you to think again and again. Somebody can unmute and answer. Who can cut that axe off? You know, taking that axe, it's very easy to say, I'll take the axe of vairagya and chop off the tree of samsara. Who can do that?
Shastra Guru Upadesha.
Yes, by Shastra Upadesha, who can do it?
I with the
Jnani.
A true Jnani can do it.
Only a person who has understood that samsara is mithya, that samsara is of a lower order of reality. And who can say that? Only one who has discovered the satyatvam or Brahma satyatvam or the Atma satyatvam. Once you have realized that who you are, once you have discovered the golden Buddha in you, once you have discovered the Atma tattva in you, once you have awoken up from Vyavaharika satya to Paramarthika satya, the world still exists, but now you are no longer dependent on this world. And then you still enjoy the world for what it is, but you have a tremendous sense of vairagya. For this Atma Tattva to be awoken, we have three sadhanas. One is, the most important sadhana is Vedanta Vichara. The other is Sadguna. We may do everything, but without God's grace, without Sharanagati. That is what Swamiji has said. There are three sadhanas. One is vairagyam, the other is sharanagati or bhakti, and the catalytic part is called sadguna. If all these three are there, Brahma vichara becomes easy. The fruit of Brahma vichara is waking up from vyavahara to paramarthika. And when you wake up, one thing happens. You don't have to chop off the tree at all. It is like a dream world. This world is not going to affect you at all. So that is what this beautiful verse we have to remember again and again. Asanga shastrena dridena chitva. We go to verse number 4. Shiv Kumar, please.
Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha. Dr. Satyanarayana has explained about asangham, asanga tattva. And doctor has beautifully captured all the aspects of the different aspects required. I'll start with chanting the verse. Tathap padam तत् परिमार्ग मार्गितव्यम् यस्मिन् गथा न निवर्तन्ति भूया तमेव चाद्यं पुरुषं प्रपद्ये यथा प्रवृत्ति प्रसृता पुराणि. In the first two verses of this chapter, we have heard of Lord Krishna describing samsara, awakening us to the huge samsara tree of avastha, problems, while igniting our desire for moksha, a desire to find an exit from this samsara. Then on, he is explaining four sadhanas for samsara nivritti. First is vairagyam or asangatvam, shifting from the world dependence to God dependence to self-dependence. Second one is sharanagati or surrender to the Lord. Third one is development of healthy virtues of the mind for self-knowledge, that is sadhana chatushtraya sampatti. The fourth sadhana is Vedanta vichara, consisting of shravanam, mananam and nididhyasanam. Ignorance is removed only by knowledge generated by Vedanta vichara, which is the primary cause. The other three sadhanas are only supportive to prepare the condition of the mind. Tatha means thereafter. That is, after getting vairagyam. Learning from our own experiences, after attaining healthy dispassion, we must strive for parimargitavyam. Parimarganam means self-enquiry, enquiry or vichara of tatpadam. That Brahman, that penultimate destination of life, the ultimate substratum, the root of the samsara vriksha, the ultimate goal of every human being, through the scriptures as an instrument, that is Shastra Pramanam, because Atma Vichara is the same as Vedanta Vichara. Therefore, Parimarganam is the consistent systematic study of Shastras under the guidance of a qualified guru. The third line of the verse, Tameva Chadyam Purusham Prapadye. Any human undertaking can be successful only when there is a sincere effort, that is Prayatna and Ishvara Anugraha. A devotee must surrender to the Lord, who is referred here as Purusha. Purusha means the all-pervading Brahman, and another explanation is the indweller of the indweller or the Puram, which is the body. Hence, I surrender to the all-pervading Lord, who is also in my heart. We cannot love Ishvara and love the material world at the same time. Seeking refuge in Ishvara will help us cultivate dispassion towards samsara. If we cannot control our mind and senses, we are yet to cultivate real devotion for Ishvara. First, practicing Karma Yoga, we should reduce selfish actions, increase selfless actions, drop our attitude of doership. Devotion coupled with dispassion towards the world will result in our liberation, the goal from which there is no turning back to this material world. The Lord, who is Yatha Purani Pravritti Prashtha, this creation which is most ancient, which emerges from the Lord, and to this Lord I surrender, Sharanagati. So as a farmer will sow seed only after preparing the land. The first line of the verse, Tatha, means thereafter. After preparing our mind with sadhana chatushtaya sampatti, all our rituals are called samskara. Our entire religious life is for this preparation with a refined mind, parimargitavyam, to study Vedanta Vichara seriously and systematically. And therefore, Krishna says, Yasmin Gatha, attaining Brahman, Moksha, Bhuyaha na Nivartanti. One does not come back to the perpetual struggle of samsara with moksha. The perpetual struggle of samsara ends once and for all. With this, we understood the three sadhanas, Vairagyam, Sharanagati and Vedanta Vichara. The fourth sadhana is explained in the next verse. Hari Om.
Thank you. Thank you, Shiv Kumar, for a nice explanation of another very beautiful verse. That is why chapter 15 is so wonderful. This question is open to you and open to everybody else. This verse makes one promise. Shri Krishna gives this promise many times. And I would like you to tell me where else is this promise given. Tat padam, that goal, which is the goal of Brahman or the goal of Parimarth Gitavyam. That means where you have realized who you are. Yasmin gata. Once you reach that place, na nivartante, there is no coming back. That means once you have understood who you are you going to forget your higher self? You are not going to do that. Can you tell me, anybody can unmute and tell me?
Sanatana Sayate Suryo, 15.6, sir.
Here he's talking about once you have reached that goal, I will promise you there is no coming back.
In the 8th chapter, sir?
Which verse? Tell me which verse where he said. I will clearly remember one view. There may be many places I know.
Chapter 2, last verse.
Absolutely right. What is that verse? Once you have it, this is only one. I know there are more than one. Now we have 72 people now listening. Now Krishna has given us this promise. Now can we do whatever we can do amongst ourselves to say that this is going to be our clear vision? We don't have to understand too many spiritual texts. We don't have to go to Brahma Sutras. We don't have to go to many Upanishads. Let us understand one verse of this particular Gita. The Gita alone is enough. If this Gita study or few Upanishads can give us this vision, nishta, very, very clearly, that is what is Parimargitamuvyam. You have understood Brahma Satyam Jagan Mithya. If this understanding is very clear, then what happens? There is no more coming back. There is no more relative world for all of us. What good news, no? See, these are promises, and that is why we say the Bhagavad Gita is a scripture where we have to listen to it, Shraddha. It is gospel truth. It is not Sri Krishna giving, you know, just empty words. These are not empty words. These are words thanks to our teachers. Our teachers have seen them. And through satsanga, let it be something absolutely real for us. So, Nita, another very beautiful verse.
Shri Guru Bhyo Namaha. Nirmana moha jita sanga dosha adhyatma nitya vinivritta kama dvandvaira vimukta sukha dukha samne Gachanti Amuda Padam Avyayam Tat. The 15th chapter is very profound. It gives a very nice analogy in the first 2.5 verses of Samsara with Ashwatha tree. And then Krishna goes on to give the four disciplines which are required for the freedom from this Samsara. Samsara Nivritti Upaya. To repeat the four disciplines, they are Vairagya, Sharanagati, Sadachar Sadgunas, and the Vedanta Vicharas. Sorry. In this verse, Krishna speaks of the virtues, the Sadgunas that help us in spiritual growth by Chitta Shuddhi. Krishna has mentioned these virtues in chapter 13, and he mentions again a few of them here. What are they? The first virtue he mentions is Nirmana, also same as Amanatvam. We must develop humility. At no point while walking the spiritual path must we allow vanity or arrogance to creep into us. It is very easy for arrogance to get into our head. One small praise and we lose our balance. In comparison to the cosmic intelligence, cosmic talent, glories, and the cosmic faculties, what are we? We must remember that we are working for the CEO, Nothing is mine and I may use it, but I have to return it back. Therefore, I cannot afford arrogance, no arrogance. Swamiji says, doing namaskara and remembering that there are so many who are better than me will keep me humble. The next virtue mentioned is nirmoha, freedom from delusion. That means proper discrimination. As an individual, I know I am a mix of Atma Tattvam and Anatma Tattvam. Swamiji says, balance our material needs with the spiritual pursuits. Nirmoha is knowing that what are we at the Vyavarika level and what is the Paramatmika level. We must have the ability to discriminate of what is Satya and what is Mithya. Krishna mentions Jitta Sangha Dosha. Sangha is emotional attachment, leaning on the world for stability, for peace, security, and happiness. So Jitta Sangha Dosha is to stop depending on the world for these for the peace, PHS, and move towards God dependence and then slowly towards self-dependence. Swami Paramatma Nanda asks us to do vratas for this. He suggests vratas in this talk. He says that giving up something that is very important to us, whom something we attach to and we like very much, give it up for a month or a day or a week, and understand that we are Purnatvam in spite of those things. Krishna continues with the next virtue as Vinivrita Kamaha. Basically, the last virtue is giving up dependence on anything we are attached to. And then this virtue is about not developing new desires. Example he gives is cigarette smoking. We want to give up cigarette smoking, but then we take up to chewing tobacco or eating pan parag. So that's a no-no. You cannot develop new desires and while giving up the old ones. The fifth virtue he mentions in this verse is dvandvai vimuktaha sukha dukha samnai, the ability to withstand opposites. Titiksha is mentioned in the second chapter. Pain and pleasures, gains and losses, we know all are going to happen. We have experienced them. Each one of us will be exposed to both. So we realize that even in any situation that appears choiceless, we always have an attitudinal choice. The reaction to every choice is our attitude. So if we have the Ishwara Prasada Bhava, we will do better. We must toughen ourselves and we must toughen ourselves and avoid violent reactions. Improve our FIR on each of these incidences. Swamiji says, be like the bouncing ball. Bounce back. Keep bouncing back. The last virtue he mentions is Adhyatma Nitya. Be committed to the spiritual pursuit. We now know the value of human life. We cannot be casual about it. How will we do it? Systematically and consistently, studying the scriptures under the guidance of a competent guru for a length of time. In the last verse, Krishna says, this person who follows all the four disciplines will achieve Gacchanti Amuda Padam Avyayam Tat. That is, this person will be wise, Amuda. And Tat Avyayam Padam Gachanti, he will reach the destination permanently, Avyayam, permanently. And Gachanti is not a physical reaching, it is an attitudinal. The knower of Brahman becomes Brahman. So, like Sir said, that is such a good promise that Krishna has given to us. If to overcome the problem of samsara, four disciplines are described in the last 2.5 verses: Vairagya, Sranagati, Sadgunas, and Vedanta Vichara. If we understand this and consistently and sincerely commit ourselves to developing these disciplines, Jivan Mukti, JM, is a high possibility in this life. Thank you, Hari Om. Sorry, took a little longer.
Thank you, Neeta, for working on this verse, even though you just traveled and maybe still jet lagged. There are three sadhanas for being able to attain to Brahma Vidya. One we said is Vairagya, the other is Sharanagati, very, very important. because without grace nothing happens. And the third is what Neeta just described about these sadgunas. Of all of them, one of the most difficult is this particular one, sadguna. That is why when we are studying the third shatkam, again and again, Krishna will remind you, are you worthy of this knowledge? Essentially, in the 15th chapter, it ends in that verse where he uses the word anaga. Yo mam eva asammodaha janati purushottama. And then he uses the word anaga. That means this knowledge will be useful only if you have all these sadgunas. If you see Swami Chinmayananda's BMI chart, you will see Omkara on top, and you will see BMI, OET, and all that. And there's one big V. That V is the block, and that V is the prod. Because of those vasanas, we have all these asuri sampatti. And unless we are able to work on those vasanas, and that is what Brahma Vidya is very easy to attain, to be able to work on this particular verse which Neeta just described, a lot of sadhana and a lot of grace is also required. Aruna, one of the most beautiful verses for you, please explain this to us.
Hari Om, thank you. This is, the verse goes like this. Na tad bhasayate suryaha na shashanko na pavakaha yad gatva nanivartante tadhama paramam mama. So this is a Brahmana Lakshana Stotra. It is basically a definition of Brahman. It is based on a mantra which is occurring in the Kathopanishad and the Mundaka Upanishad. Na tatra suryo bhati na chandra tarakam. Now this mantra from the Upanishads is mentioned, recited at aarti times in many, many temples. So Swami Param says that the essence of this mantra is the definition of Brahman. That Brahman cannot be objectified or known by any instrument of knowledge. Brahman cannot be illumined by anything, because Brahman is the root of the universe. It is a substratum of the universe. Therefore, it cannot be illumined by anything. The Upanishads point out sense organs as being compared to a light, because sense organs are those in whose presence things are known, whether they are sound, smell, taste, or even words. So anything that can be known through an instrument of knowledge is called prameya. But Lord Krishna says that Brahman is that which is not an object of knowledge, and through any instrument of knowledge, it is aprameya. So Brahman is not an object of knowledge, but Brahman does exist. So what is that Brahman? If it exists and it is not an object, it must be the subject. It is the very consciousness being which objectifies everything, but by itself cannot be objectified. It is the experiencer of everything, but it is not itself experienced. It is the unseen seer, not the unseen hearer, and the unseen smeller, etc. So the Upanishads call Brahman adrishto drashtaha amato manto asrito srota, different descriptions of Brahman. So Brahman is basically the conscious principle behind everything in this world. So let us look at this shloka in a little bit of detail. Na tad bhasayate suryo. The sunlight does not illumine the Brahma Chaitanya or consciousness. In fact, the sunlight itself is known because of the consciousness substratum. Similarly, na shashanko. Neither does the moon illumine Brahma Chaitanyam. Like the sun, it is illumined by the consciousness. Na pavakaha, that is the light. Pavakaha means the light of the fire. Now, Brahman is not illumined by the light of the fire at all. In other words, the word illumine used in Vedanta means to make something known. Brahman illumines everything, being the consciousness principle, because of which I am aware of the fire's existence or of the sun's existence or of the moon. Then Swamiji says that Brahman being the subject or the Atma, where is the home of this Atman, and or how far do we have to travel in order to reach Brahman? The travel is not even a millimeter. Because of knowledge, we discover the fact that there is actually no distance between Brahman and me. So reaching Brahman is not a physical event, but in fact, an intellectual event. And Swamiji says, what type of intellectual event is this? It is an event where you are dropping the misconception that Brahman and I are distinct, separate beings. The notional distance between Brahman and me is the misconception that Brahman is somewhere and I should do something to reach it. If the distance is caused by a false notion, how do you remove the distance? You remove the distance by knowledge. Knowledge brings about the merger. Other than jnanam, there is no merger, Lord Krishna says. Yad gatva, having merged into the Brahman, having removed the notion of distance, na nivartante, there is no question of coming back to samsara. Merger in the form of knowledge is permanent merger. Any physical merger is temporary, but the Vedantic merger is permanent. Once ignorance is gone, it's gone for good. Then, tat mama paramam dhama, that house or abode from which a person does not come back, that destination is Krishna himself, Lord Krishna himself, the higher nature, Vasudeva, Govinda, Narayana. Param dhama is para prakriti. So where is our home? We are like hunting lost in different place and don't know where home is. Home is the state of samadhi, tad vishnu paramam pada. That is the final goal. That is the final destination. Param dhama is our final destination. The merger of ourselves with the Brahman. Thank you. Hari Om.
Thank you, Aruna, for an excellent explanation. I'm sure it cannot be bettered. You have said everything that has to be said. Here is another verse which the previous quiz question I asked, where Krishna makes another promise. Having understood that, having reached that, there is no coming back. Now, this is the difficulty. You have given a very beautiful explanation, but you've also told us about the difficulty. What is the difficulty? If a Brahma Vidya Acharya like Swami Paramarthananda, our guru, has to teach us about anything. Now, all of us are teachers. We teach people about the brain, about the heart, which is an object which you can see, which you can experience, you can perceive with your sense organs. And therefore, it is very easy to teach. Now, here is something which is not an object. And because it is not an object, you do not have any means to throw light on that object. So how do you teach anybody? What instrument do you use? And this is again an open quiz. Aruna, you can answer. Anybody can answer. Now, here is the problem. Now you have to teach somebody about Atma Vidya or Atman or Brahman or your real self, which is the experiencer, which cannot be experienced. Now, to teach about anything, you can throw light on that object. But this is not an object. How do you teach?
Shastra, sir. Shastra knowledge.
Shastra knowledge.
Jnana chakshushu.
Nidityasanam.
Wisdom of knowledge.
By a lot of explanations.
The mirror of Shastra.
Anubhava. Anubhava.
Remove the ajnana.
Negation.
How guru, sampradaya, how your guru has taught you.
The guru, yeah. See, what be, as all of you have said, it has to be a combination. It has to be the anubhuti. You have to use all because it should be logical. It should be part of your experience, and there is no other way but shruti. But shruti also, you have difficulties. I will tell you about Shruti. I don't worry about the time. We have time. We will just try to break our head on this. Now, to learn anything, there are three kinds of knowledge. One is called paroksha. Paroksha means, the classical example that I would always give is the Niagara Falls or Kailash Manasarovar. Now, all of us want to know about Kailash Manasarovar. I have never been there. But I have seen images, I have seen pictures, people have told me. So mentally, I form a concept. Mentally, I have seen a picture. Because it has not come directly through my senses and it is a remote knowledge, that knowledge is called paroksha. One day, if you get the opportunity to see it with your aksha, with your eyes, you are able to see it, you are able to experience it as close. There are some people who have gone to Charan Sparsh who have been able to feel the feet of Lord Kailash. Then you have experienced it with your own senses. And now that knowledge is no longer paroksha, but it is pratyaksha. Now, there is a third kind of knowledge. And that third kind of knowledge should come under the category of Shruti, Yukti and Anubhuti. The classical example that has given is, we are trying to teach a person about not an object, but about the subject. And if it is a subject, it is me, it is something that I have experienced. But normally, what do you feel yourself? I'm this body-mind. And the teacher has to go beyond the body-mind and filter off all the body-mind and tell you to realize somebody which you have always experienced, but you have never realized. One powerful example is given by Swami Dayananda's personal experience, and I have heard him say this experience personally, of course, in a group. He was traveling from Chennai to New Delhi, and he had an Australian fellow passenger next to him. And the person was sitting next to him, and because he was a little fat, he was bulging over his seat. And as usual, Swamiji is a very talkative person. They had a long conversation. And part of the conversation went on to, where are you going? And he said, I'm going to Rishikesh. And where are you? Where in Rishikesh? I want to meet a particular Swamiji, but he could not remember the name. He took out a piece of paper and showed it to Swamiji, and it read Swami Dayananda Saraswati. Now you will see all along he had experienced Swamiji, but he did not know that the person that he was experiencing is Swami, the Swamiji that he wanted to know. And when Swamiji introduced himself, now there is a different kind of a knowledge. This kind of a knowledge where you, the experience is already there, and now you are able to introduce it. That is why all our science books are books of information. They give you information about Kailash Manasarovar, about the brain, about the heart. Our scriptures are not books of information. They are books of, can I, somebody use the word? Can you unmute and tell what kind of scriptural words? Anybody unmute and please tell me, what is the difference?
Aparoksha.
Scriptural words are not words of description. Scriptural words are words of
Anubhuti.
Introduction. They introduce you to you. And the Anubhuti you is, see, I have lived through so many bodies. If you look at your own photograph, one day you were small, one day you were a little baby, then you were a small boy, then you have grown up. Your body has changed, but the indweller has not changed. These are all experiences of Anubhuti. That means there is one factor which is constant, although the body has been changing. I have lived in three worlds in Tripura. In my dream world, I have observed the dream world. In my deep sleep, I know I have slept well. And when I am awake, I know I'm experiencing. There is that Sakshi principle in and through. And that is what is called the Anubhuti. So you have through Shruti, through Anubhuti, and also through logic, if you're able to understand that constant factor, and then once Brahma Vidya comes, this has to become a Nishta. Tat gatva na nivartante. Once you have understood, there is no coming back. Then we will work on Sadguna, we will work on Sharanagati, we will work on Guru's grace. Now these are some things which are called Pratibandha Nivritti. There are still obstacles that we need to work on. Brahma Vidya has come, but Brahma Vidya has now to become a Nishta. Now, if you surrender to an Acharya, you surrender to the Lord, through grace, you will be able to work on the Pratibandha, when Jnanam now becomes a Jnana Nishta. We go to the last verse today, and Dr. Vasumati, I'm not sure if it's the last verse, but...
Last but one.
Go ahead.
Shri Gurubhyo Namaha. Mamaiva Amsho Jiva Bhutaha Sanatanaha Manashashtani Indriyani Prakrutistani Karshati. Tatparya,
a part of myself alone is in the form of the eternal Jiva in the world of beings. He pulls the five sense organs with mind as the sixth, which reside in the body. Swami Param says, from this verse onwards, Krishna is entering into another very important topic of Brahman alone being in the form of the whole universe, which means there is no universe at all other than Brahman. Just as saying there are no ornaments other than the gold, similarly, there is no substance called world. Brahman alone is known by the name of world. Brahman alone is in the form of everything. And to convey this idea, Krishna divides the entire world into two parts. One part is the Jiva Rupa, the conscious experiences known as Jivaha. And the second part is the inert objects of experience called Jagat. So universe is nothing but Jiva plus Jagat, the experiencer plus experiences, the Pramata and Prameya. So what is the definition of Jivaha? Krishna defines Jiva as all-pervading Brahma Chaitanyam, all-pervading consciousness, which is reflected or manifest in one body-mind reflecting medium. We call this Chaitanya Pratibimba Jivaha. The original all-pervading consciousness, OC, is when it is expressing through the body-mind, then that is reflected or manifest consciousness, which is called as reflected consciousness, RC. And this body-mind-matter medium is called the reflecting medium. Let's understand this through an example. Imagine during the daytime, there's the original sun in the sky and a room below. Because of the room is dark within. There's no light. You place a mirror so as to reflect the sunlight in the room. The sun alone illumines the dark room, not directly, but through the mirror. In the same way, our body-mind complex is also like a mirror. The original consciousness is Brahman. The reflected consciousness is Jiva. The body-mind complex is reflecting medium. It does not have sentience of its own. Body is an inert matter. Mind is an inert matter. Just as the mirror by itself is non-luminous. And suppose you remove the mirror, what happens? Original sunlight will be there. But since the mirror is removed, there would be no reflection. The room will remain dark. Similarly, during sleep, the mind mirror is removed and therefore the RC is not available and the world becomes dark. The mind has resolved, therefore the world is not illumined, but the OC continues to be. Now look at the shloka. Mamaiva Amshaha. Amshaha means reflection. Mama means that mind, that is Brahman's. We know Brahman is OC, therefore Mama Amshaha means reflection of OC. And what is that reflection? It is nothing but RC. Mamaiva Amshaha Jiva Bhutaha. It is in the form of the Jivas. And Krishna says, Jiva Loke, in the world of Jivas, I, the Brahman alone, am in the form of reflection. And this RC makes the body-mind complex alive and sentient. Once the RC is not there, the body will become dead matter. The Jivaha is eternal, Sanatanaha. At the time of death also, Jiva does not die. Death belongs to the physical body alone. What does the Jiva do? Indriyani Karshati. Not only the RC goes away, but it drags the entire Sukshma Shariram along with that. And we know Sukshma Shariram consists of all the sense organs. The sense organs does not mean the physical sense organ, which is called Golakam. But behind the Golakam, the sensory perception faculty is there, which is called Indriyani. They are taken, Karshati, dragged. Not only the sense organs, Manashashtani, which includes the sixth component, the mind. Thus, not only the five Gnanendriyas, but the mind behind the sense organs are also taken away when the Jiva, that is the RC, goes away, or to say, leaves the body. Hari Om.
Thank you, Dr. Vasumati. That is why I said to be able to understand these verses, you need a good idea of Tattva Bodha. What is this original consciousness? What is this reflecting media? What is this reflected consciousness, which she nicely described as the dark room, the mirror, and this whole verse. So with the understanding, we will be able to understand how we function and what is OC. What is the reflecting media? What is the reflected consciousness and so on? We come to the last verse of today. Shyamala, can you please explain this verse?
Hari Om. 15th chapter, 8th sloka. Shariram yadavapnoti yachapyutkramuti matishwaraha gruhi tvaitari samyati vayurgandhani nashayat. What does the jiva do at the time of death is explained here. And peculiarly, instead of using the word jiva, in this verse, Krishna uses the word Ishvara to indicate that jiva is none other than Ishvara itself in reflected form, because we do not treat a reflection as different from the original. Swami Paramarthananda gives an example. When you want to show your college group photo to your friend, you just show the photo and tell that I am in the photo and identified. Really speaking, we are not in the photo. Our image alone is in the photo, and I look upon my image as myself. I claim it as myself. Similarly, Bhagavan does not look at Jiva as someone different. Bhagavan says, the Jiva who is none other than Ishvara himself. In the shloka, Yachapi Utkramati, this should be read first, then Shariram Avapnoti should be read later. This means at the time of the death, the Jiva quits the current body and later it acquires a new body. While leaving, Etani Grihatva. Grihatva means takes. Jiva takes. Takes what? Etani. Etani referred to in the seventh verse. It denotes all the pancha jnanendriyani, pancha karmendriyani, pancha prana, mana, buddhi, chitta, ankara, all different tools we use for transactions. Jiva takes away all these with it. The body is only a rented house. When these invisible tools have been kept by me, and once I am changing my rented house, the invisible tools are taken and I enter another physical body. Samyati, he goes. How he goes? A beautiful example. This is the punchline of this verse. Yatha vayur gandhan ashaya. Ashaya means flower. Gandha means the fragrance of the flower. So vayu means wind. When the wind blows over the flower, the wind carries the fragrance from the flower and it travels. The invisible wind carries the invisible fragrance from the visible flower. Similarly, the invisible jiva takes away the invisible sukshma shariram from the visible sthula shariram. Then the body has become dead. So this is called from one janma to another janma. What is the next job? All the packed parcels, sukshma sharira, will be dumped in the new house. Now we have to open all parcels and keep everything in their respective places. Jnanendriya and Karmendriya should be placed properly. Each faculty has got a physical position. Faculty is called Indriyam and the physical location is called Golakam. Then the life starts till the body is dropped. Then another body, because we have a lot of unfulfilled desires which propels a person to travel. Punarapi Jananam, Punarapi Maranam. Jnani will not have unfulfilled desire. He says, Prajahat yada kaman sarvan partha manogatan atmani eva atmana tushtaha stita prajnaha tada uchyate. Jnani is full and complete. Further travel is not there, because the fuel for the travel is kama and karma. When the fuel is gone, they give the example of the flame with wick and oil. When the oil is dried out, the flame will be put out. Means the flame will join the total fire principle. Jnani does not travel. Ajnani will continuously travel. In the next verse, we shall see how Jiva enjoys the sense objects again with all the sense organs he has brought with him. This is the Jiva's journey. And what Krishna wants to highlight is all these functions of Jiva is the proof of the existence of the original consciousness, Brahman. Hari Om.
Thank you, Shamila. Shamila and Vasumati have so nicely explained what happens normally when a person dies. What happens to the gross body? What happens to the subtle body? And how we move from one body to another, carrying all our vasanas and all, and then put them. Now the big question is, we have done that so many times. Are we going to do that anymore? It is high time that we declare that because we have got the grace of great acharyas like this, let us shift our gears altogether. We don't want this again and again, going back to nursery, going back to school again. You also spoke about those nice verses about Atmaneva Atmana Tushtaha. Another verse that comes to my mind is Vedanta Vijnana Sunishtithartha. Now, if Brahma Vidya is very clear, Sannyasa Yoga Yata Yaha Shuddha Sattva, with all your right efforts, and if you have trained your mind, then where do you go? A Brahma Loke. Brahma Loke is only a, you attain to what these previous verses said. You attain to Tat Padam. You attain to that goal. And then what kind of death you are going to have? Is it going to be a death which Shamila and Vasumati described? It is going to be Parantakala. Parantakala means because of the agni of the fire of knowledge, all the karmas of basmata, basmasat kurute tatha, all the, when there is nothing left, and that is what we need to work on. Through this jnanam we are going to work on, that kind of knowledge is called aparoksha jnanam. Now all of us have got one very clear aparoksha jnanam. What is that? Aparoksha jnanam is that knowledge which does not need any instrument to know. What is that knowledge? All of us are 100% clear. Anybody can unmute and tell.
I am existing.
I am. To say I am. About I am, you don't need any doctor to come and say that you are. You don't need your eyes. You don't need someone to tell you and touch you and use any sense organs. That knowledge which you are absolutely convinced of is I am. But what aparoksha jnanam we need is I am Brahman. I am Atma. I am Atma Brahma. Aham Brahmasmi. That knowledge has to become a nishta. Let us see how this chapter, the 15th chapter, is going to introduce to us Purushottama. Let us do all our sadhanas. In this chapter itself, there I said we need vairagya. And vairagya comes through Brahma Vidya only. That means you devalue the world. We need sadguna. We need sharanagati, Vedanta vichara. And hope with all these, we will be able to get not only the grace of Brahma Vidya, but the Brahma Vidya now becomes a nishta for all of us. Om Purnamada Purnamidam Purnat Purnamudachyate Purnasya Purnamadaya Purnamevavashishyate. Om Shanti Shanti Shanti. Thank you very much for all the speakers. Excellent presentation today. Enjoy.